Hello everyone, welcome to today's live broadcast, the Human Connectome Project. I am Brenda Kelly Kim of Lab Roots, and I'll be your moderator for today's events. We have a few important announcements before we begin. This presentation has been approved for a Category 1 Continuing Medical Education credit by Loma Linda University. If you are interested in obtaining CMEs after attending this presentation, please click on the Get Your Free CME CE Credits button in the bottom left corner of the event screen. This webcast is designed to be interactive, and we encourage you to ask questions during the event. You can submit questions by typing them in the Q&A box, which can be found by clicking on the green Q&A button at the lower left of the presentation window. We'll try to answer as many questions as we can. You can enlarge the slide window by clicking on the screen icon in the lower right-hand corner of the slide window. If you have any technical problems viewing or hearing this presentation, please click on the support button at the top right of your presentation window or submit your problem through the green Q&A button, lower left. I would now like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. David Van Essen. David Van Essen is currently alumni endowed professor in the Department of Anatomy and Neurobiology at Washington University in St. Louis. He is internationally known for his research on the structure, function, connectivity, and development of cerebral cortex in humans and non-human primates. He and his colleagues have developed powerful methods of computerized brain mapping with a particular emphasis on surface-based visualization and analysis of cerebral cortex. He is currently principal investigator for the Human Connectome Project, or HCP, an ambitious endeavor to map brain function and connectivity in healthy adults. The HCP is setting new standards for sharing rich and complex neuroimaging data sets with the scientific community. We will now turn it over to Dr. Van Essen for his presentation.
Greetings to everyone. I'm delighted for this opportunity to tell you some interesting facts and principles about the human brain and its structure, function, and connectivity. If we can get the first slide here. I'm not seeing the slides displaying yet. Do I need to do something? I'm hitting next. I'm hitting next and nothing is happening. I'm hitting next in the lower corner as I'm instructed. And I'm using my arrow keys as I'm instructed. I'm trying to make this happen, but it is not yet working. Slide two is up, I'm told. I don't actually see it. Okay, I'll go ahead and talk, but you'll have to tell me what slides I'm are actually seeing. So the human brain has some interesting numbers associated with it. The dominant structure is the cerebral cortex, which contains about 80% of the tissue mass, but only about 20% of the 80 billion neurons in the whole brain. That's because it's chock-a-block full of synapses, literally more than 100 trillion of them. And it's also interconnected with other regions of the brain through literally 100,000 miles of white matter. Now I'm going to, if you can advance to the cerebellum, the little arrow shows that the cerebellum right below the cerebral cortex is 10% of brain mass, but over 80% of the total neuronal count. Click next, please, and you'll see that the rest of the brain is even smaller, 10% of the tissue, but only 1% of the neurons. So our great challenge is to untangle the wiring of the brain. Next slide, please. There are many intervening clicks, so it's very hard for me to tell what the audience is seeing. Someone needs to tell me, are we on slide three now? Okay, the brain is in many ways like a computer, but it is very different in its physical structure. The challenge with computers, the brain contains, communicates by means of electrical signals that come in from incoming signals onto the dendritic, the antenna-like dendrites, and it sends its outputs to make synapses on the target structures by means of axonal branches, and there are about 10,000 inputs and outputs per neuron. A computer operates at vastly greater speeds, billions of operations per second instead of the 1 to 100 impulses per second for neurons. And so there are profoundly different ways that they operate, but they are the challenge for computers is to decipher the operating system, the hardware, and the applications that operate. Whereas for the human brain, the challenge is to understand the wiring, the signals, the physiological signals, and combine those together to explain behavior. If we go to slide number four, that brings us to a world of connectomics, analogous to the genomics that is used to study the sequence of the genetic code. For connectomics, the aspiration is to obtain comprehensive maps of neuronal connections. These connections are can only be studied to a limited resolution. For the human brain, our aspiration is to study long-distance connections from one patch of gray matter, the neuronal composition of the brain, to another through the underlying white matter, but that can only be done down to the resolution of the underlying volume elements, or so-called voxels, and that's the macro connectome. If we advance to the image that's on the right side, that's the world of the micro connectome, which aspires to understand brain circuits, but at a literally a microscopic level to study every synapse, neuron, dendrite, and glial cell, but can only do that up to a small fraction of a cubic millimeter. In the middle panel, you may need to advance, there's a world of microconnectomics and mesoconnectomics in which tracer methods are used in laboratory animals to study local and long distance connections. So for our presentation today, we'll talk about the macroconnectome. If we go to slide number five, we have a full agenda that we'll try to work through with our visualization challenges here. I'm going to talk first about some fundamental principles of the organization and structure and connectivity of the mammalian cerebral cortex in general. Then I'll get on to the Human Connectome Project proper. In slide number six, We see that brains do indeed come in very different sizes. Our brains are quite large, several times larger than that of the chimpanzee, our closest living relative, which in turn is several times larger than that of the macaque monkey, which in turn is 100 times larger than the intensively studied but lowly mouse brain. Their brains not only come in different sizes, but they're tremendously different in the pattern of folds or so-called convolutions, and that brings us to the realm of cortical cartography. In slide 7, we see that there are many ways to map the cerebral cortex. I started as a cortical cartographer some 40 years ago studying the anatomy of the macaque monkey's visual system, and I got frustrated by the challenges of looking at data only on one anatomical slice compared to another, so I literally used pencils and tracing paper to generate what we call flat maps of small patches of the cortex. And in the middle panel, you should see that there are ways to use that pencil and tracing paper approach to make flat maps of the entire cerebral cortex in the macaque monkey. And in the right panel, you may need to advance, you see a colorized version in which several dozen visual areas of the macaque monkey were identified from studies in the scientific literature and used to combine information from multiple methods or modalities to parcelate the brain based on differences in structure, function, architecture, connectivity, or topography. Some of these areas, like area V1 and MT, are the poster children, as it were, because they are well identified by each of these methods. But as the remaining text elements show, there are great challenges in deciphering the parcels of the cerebral cortex in most regions because the methods are noisy and there are biases and difficulties in accurate parcelation. So it's a really hard but extremely important challenge. And if we go to slide 8, you can see that there's been tremendous advance enabled by magnetic resonance imaging here. You're looking at a structural MRI scan, a so-called T1 weighted scan that on the left lets us capture the shape of the cortical folds slice by slice and then use sophisticated computer algorithms to segment or reconstruct the shape of the entire cerebral cortical mantle. And on the right you see a three-dimensional computerized model of the cerebral cortex that we can spin around and inflate and manipulate to study it in great detail. If we go to slide number 9, you'll see that we can look at the parcelation in a modern day version for three different species. On the left panel, you see a parcelation of the entire cerebral cortex of the lowly mouse. It contains about 40 distinct areas that are here visualized on a physically flattened and tangentially sliced section through the entire cerebral cortex. This is the closest to ground truth we have for any species to parcelate its cerebral cortex. In the middle panel, you can see an updated version of the macaque monkey's parcelation, about 130 cortical areas identified from various studies and an approximation, but it's still a lot of uncertainty and debate about which of these are most reliable. In the panels on the right, you see a recent, but not the latest, version of the parcelation of the human cerebral cortex based on a number of anatomical and fMRI, functional MRI studies that cover in aggregate accurate maps for about a third of the cerebral cortex and constituting 50 or so cortical areas. If we go to the next slide, number 10, we see in the upper panels maps of the macaque monkey on the left and the human on the right two panels, and they are colorized to show the regions of cerebral cortex that expanded most in the evolution between monkeys and humans. And what's notable is that their red hotspots of cortical expansion are concentrated in lateral regions of parietal in the upper left, prefrontal and temporal cortex where the arrows are pointing. And if we go to the lower panels, you can see a different kind of colorization because these are maps of monkey and human cortex that identify regions of heavy myelination in red and regions of very light myelination in blue and indigo. What's notable is that the regions of light myelination are this basically the same as the regions of cortical expansion in the upper panels, and it indicates that the regions that we are implicated in higher cognitive function are not only extensively expanded in the human lineage, but they're also more lightly myelinated. They have a lot more synapses, and that's used for essentially giving increased computational horsepower. If we go to slide 11, it will take us to the next topic of cortical connectivity. And then slide 12, we again do a very brief historical review. In the upper left is a decades old, very outdated scheme of a few pathways linking different cortical areas that were known in the 1970s. In the upper right panel, you can see the wiring diagram became more complex as advances in pathway tracing in the macaque monkey were carried out. In the lower left panel, you can see a colorized version that shows the same flat map of monkey cortex I showed before. And then in the second panel, you can see a subway chart type of complexity that shows literally hundreds of pathways interlinking dozens of visual areas that were known 20 years ago. In the middle panel on the lower side, you can see what we call a binary connectivity matrix showing the presence or absence of these hundreds of possible pathways between one cortical area and any other in the rows and columns of the matrix. In the lower right, you can see, so one of the frustrations of that early days of modern neuroanatomy was that we lacked quantitative evidence of the strength of connections, even though we knew some were massively powerful and some were very weak. In the lower right, you see evidence for quantitative connectivity studies that were done in my laboratory for a small number of cortical areas examined, but it was really hard to do that systematically. And it wasn't until a few years ago that Henry Kennedy's lab in France advanced the effort by making tracer injections systematically into dozens of different cortical areas. In the lower left, you see one example of a tracer injection placed into cortical area 7A, and the red little dots show the pattern of tracer-labeled neurons that provide the anatomical inputs to area 7A. And in the upper panel right above that, you see the 91 areas of the cortical parcellations used by this group. In the middle panels, you can see that the strength of the connections between different cortical areas to the input area 7A vary over a very wide range because the color scale is in logarithmic units. And in the lower middle panel, you can see that those strengths of connections vary over literally five orders of magnitude from the strongest to the weakest in a very systematic trend. This was done by the Kennedy's group for 29 different areas. And in the lower right, you can see a cortical connectivity matrix that is now in a quantitative rather than purely a binary mode that reveals evidence for the strength of over 1,600 pathways that are a subset of the total possible. We estimated in the monkey there may be at least 10,000 pathways of widely varying strength suggested by this analysis. And in the human, there's going to be even more, surely, once we ever get it sorted out. So in the next slide, number 14, you can see another really important issue. When we look closely at the human cerebral cortex, we find it's tremendously variable in its folding pattern from one individual to the next. But that's seen in the upper left panels for four different individuals where some regions are highly variable. And that pattern of variability can also be illustrated in the upper right panel where the folding maps are displayed by on an inflated surface, but the darker the streaks are, the deeper it is in the three-dimensional surface. And if you keep clicking through there, you'll see that there's a variability is greatest in some regions, in particular in the regions that we saw are associated with cognitive function in a slide a few moments ago. And strikingly, that variability is evident even in identical twins. The upper two panels are from one pair of twins, the lower two are from another pair of twins, and despite that genetic identity of their developmental instruction kit, the outcomes of the folding is very different, even though there is some degree of heritability when one looks very closely. The bottom right shows that another critical feature is that the distinct cortical areas of the type that I showed in previous slides are themselves quite variable in relation to cortical folds. So the red patches in three different individual brains show the variability in the primary visual cortex relative to the underlying cortical folds. So that brings us to the question of what makes the cortex fold, and slide 15 draws our attention in the top panels to the fact that the occurrence of folding is predominantly in the last 3 months, the last trimester of human gestation, and that's around the time that the long distance pathways are being established in the underlying cortical white matter. That led me some years ago to hypothesize that the establishment of long distance connections is critical for the induction of cortical folding by virtue of mechanical tension generated by all of these literally billions of tiny axons. If they all tug gently and tug together, they're going to bring strongly connected regions closer together, forming a gyrus in between. And that is a mechanism that could, in principle, account for the consistency of folding in strongly connected regions dominated by major pathways, whereas the highly variable folding I told you about a few moments ago may occur in balkanized regions that are characterized by little tiny cortical areas and variability in their connectivity. So this is an attractive hypothesis, but we actually don't know if it's true yet. It's controversial, but it forms a useful framework for thinking about what's actually going on. So slide 16, brings us now to our main agenda, which is the Human Connectome Project. And slide 17, if we walk through that, we can see that the first objective of the Human Connectome Project, it's a five-year, $30 million grant funded by the National Institutes of Health. The first objective is to acquire data on brain structure and function and connectivity in healthy adult twins and their siblings. We use improved scanners and better methods of data acquisition, what we call pulse sequences for the magnetic resonance imaging. And we do this by in a way that involves 4 hours of total scan time spread out over four sessions in 2 days for each participant. And we get exceptionally high data quality that is now 900 subjects acquired, and we've released a large fraction of that data and much more to come. Some of these subjects are also scanned in the University of Minnesota, our partner institution, at an even higher magnetic field strength. And we've also acquired and released data using a different modality called magnetoencephalography that gives faster time resolution but coarser spatial resolution, but having it in the same individuals adds greatly to the strength of our overall portfolio. The second large bullet is that we are not only acquiring the HCP data, but we're analyzing it using extensively improved methods of processing the data and improved ways of visualizing the data and various advanced analysis methods. The next slide, number 18, points to the importance of sharing all this data. So we've developed a robust database called ConnectomeDB that is the portal for the community to tap into the 500 subjects for whose data we've already released and forthcoming expansion of that. More than 2,500 investigators have already signed on to our data use terms and acquired the data, and they've tapped into more than 3 petabytes of data that's been shared by downloading or shifting of hard drives. We're releasing many other types of data as well. And as slide 19 lets me acknowledge, this fruits of this labor come from intense efforts over the past 5 years by a highly dedicated group of 100 investigators and team members. Slide number 20 lets me make brief notion to the opportunity if you're interested in the type of information that I'm talking about today in the course of the remainder of this hour. You might be interested in immersing yourself for a week-long experience of intensively looking at the data that will be discussed and shared and analyzed in the Human Connectome Project course that will be held in June in Hawaii. So why is this data better to begin with? One critical aspect of it is that the improved imaging strategies developed for this purpose include a method known as multi-slice or multi-band imaging that are schematized on slide 22. And it basically involves exciting not just one slice at a time through the brain as has been conventionally done, but exciting up to 8 slices at a time, and then using the little circles there show the schematization of the elements in the receiving elements in the head coils that can extract and pick out the nature of the signals and the source of the signal from each slice at a time. Now I'll look at question. There are some questions, but I think I'll, the question is, do I think that MRI and TMS can advance current knowledge? And the answer is multimodal methods are increasingly powerful. And there are some great opportunities, and maybe we'll come back to that at the end. Slide number 22 brings us into one particular imaging modality, that of diffusion imaging. And this, to set the stage for it, the focus is on what's going on in the underlying white matter. If we look in the lower left, you can see that a blunt dissection of the brain reveals a cable-like structure that indicates that fiber bundles tend to run in parallel with one another, just as in a well-wired electronic circuit. But in the lower right panel, you can see that there's, even from blunt dissection, evidence for crisscrossing of fibers. And in the lowest right panel, it's a reminder that the incredibly complex anatomical wiring that I pointed out in an earlier slide is evidence that the wiring within the white matter must truly be very complex to account for all that complexity of connectivity between brain gray matter areas. Slide number 23 brings us to this particular modality called diffusion imaging, which uses a particular kind of MRI pulse sequences to probe the rate of diffusion of water and capitalize on the fact that water molecules diffuse more rapidly along the length of fiber bundles, then kind of crisscross inside and outside of each individual axon. So the colorizing there illustrates that one can pick up the dominant direction of fiber diffusion that varies from one patch of the white matter to another. In the middle and right panels on the top point to the ability using the HCP style of diffusion imaging pulse sequences to infer not just the dominant fiber orientation, but up to two or three additional fiber bundles. So it's possible to estimate where the fibers are crisscrossing one another. And we're able to do that much more effectively using the various advances in hardware and full sequence of acquisition of the HCP project. Slide number 24 shows on the left panels of what one learns from diffusion imaging with conventional data acquisition. In particular, the lower left one labeled FA is a measure of fractional anisotropy that quantifies the dominant fiber orientation. And in the panels on the right, you can see the crisper, higher quality fractional anisotropy estimates provided by the HCP data. So if we go to slide number 25, you can see in the left a conventional pathway traced using diffusion imaging data, but using a method called tractography to infer long distance connections through the white matter revealed by contiguous alignment of fiber bundles. And in the panels on the right, you can basically see that using the HCP style data, we get much higher quality of tractography information that we believe is a better, albeit not perfect, representation of the underlying anatomical connectivity. In slide number 26, we can carry this further and use a seed location in the inferior frontal gyrus, a little patch of at the boundary between gray and white matter, to explore connectivity from one gray matter region to another. In the expanded panel on the right, you can see the fiber orientation bundles through all of the voxels or volume elements through one slice. And in slide number 27, we see that the seed location in the inferior frontal gyrus picks out, using a method known as probabilistic tractography, just the trajectories of fiber bundles associated with this particular seed location in gray matter. And in slide number 28, we see a three-dimensional model of the same pathway showing the trajectory of those fiber bundles going through long distances through the 3D white matter. And in slide number 29, we can connect from one region of white matter to another. In the lower panels, you can see in the lower left connectivity from one patch of the frontal cortex to local and long distance regions. In the red shows where there's strong connectivity, and an inflated map on the lower right, you can see the same pattern of connectivity, but more sensitively revealed by averaging across a group of 9 subjects. If we go to slide number 30, and walk through the upper left panels illustrate a geometric problem that is a real challenge for diffusion imaging and tractography. Basically, it relates to the fact that the white matter bundles as they approach the cortex are narrowed down into what we call blades of white matter feeding into each sulcus and gyrus. And because of the limited resolution of the tractography and diffusion imaging methods, the fiber bundles are dominated by the those heading to the crowns of the gyrus near the top in panel D and E. And over on the right, you can see that if we just count the total degree of connectivity, there's an apparent bias suggesting that connections are stronger to gyral crowns, but in the lower white panel on the lower right, we know that that conflicts with the ground truth anatomy that I showed in the previous slide. And so basically, in this particular modality, we have to face the reality that the estimates we get of connection strength are confounded by methodological biases and limitations. And we basically need to get better data, use better modeling methods to improve this, ameliorate the situation to some degree. But in the meanwhile, be careful not to overinterpret the experimental data. Slide number 31 moves us to the next modality, functional MRI. And to set the stage for that, the first thing I'll note in slide 32 is that the colorful maps on the left show a representation of how thick the cortical sheet is in different regions. In some regions, shown in red and orange, the cortical ribbon is 3 to 4 millimeters thick, whereas in other regions shown in blue and indigo and black, it's only a couple of millimeters thick. So that's just natural differences in variations across different regions. But this is important because as the lower text bullets show, conventional fMRI is acquired with a relatively coarse resolution that is actually larger than the thickness of the cortical ribbon, whereas the main HCP data acquired with the 3-Tesla scanner is at about 2 millimeters, which captures the cortical ribbon information more accurately. And for the subjects we're scanning at 7 Tesla, it does even better because the resolution is 1.6 millimeters. So if we bear that in mind as we now move in slide 33 to the modality of what we call task-evoked functional MRI, we have a total of 7 tasks done over a time frame of an hour in total for each participant. I'll show very quickly examples of 3 of those tasks. One is listening to stories versus doing arithmetic in your head. Another is what we call a social interaction task, looking and interpreting whether there's social significance to little triangles that are dancing and hugging and kissing versus moving randomly on the screen. And in the lower right, there's a working memory task. In slide 34, you can see the way in which we're arranging the anatomical substrate for viewing task fMRI data. So you see on the left, inflated surfaces of the left and right cerebral hemispheres. On the upper right are slices through the underlying subcortical structures. And in the lower right is the representation of the cerebellum flattened out into a sheet-like arrangement. In the first panel of slide 35, you see the results for the first of those tasks, the language versus task contrasting story versus doing math. In the second panel, you see a very different pattern of brain activation that is elicited by looking at socially interacting triangles versus randomly moving triangles. And in the third and last panel on this slide, there is a representation of what's going on when you're remembering things you just saw a few moments ago, a so-called working memory task. And in each of these three, the two important messages are that there's not just one hotspot of brain activation for any given task. There's a very complex pattern of activations and deactivations, or turning up and down neural activity depending on the particular task, and any given brain region may be involved in multiple tasks in a very complicated, exquisitely orchestrated network of activation that we aim to decipher. The other modality that helps us out here is what we call resting state functional MRI. That relies on the fact that when a subject is lying in the scanner doing no task at all, but just staring at a screen with its eyes open, the brain is still very, very active in a pattern that fluctuates in space and time. as schematized by the single frame shown in the left-hand panel. In the middle panels, the locations number 1 and 2 show samples of the time course of the resting state functional MRI signal that we can pick up in our data. And in some comparisons, when we look to correlate, we see that the signals in blue and red are strongly correlated with one another. For other pairs of locations, the signals are anti-correlated. In other regions, they're more or less uncorrelated. If we do that for every pairwise possibility, we find in the upper right panel that we can generate an incredibly rich and informative, dense functional connectivity matrix that literally contains 30 gigabytes worth of data from each individual subject. We can analyze it in an individual, or we can analyze it in a group average. And in the lower right, you can see our ability to probe functional connectivity using a point and click probe a given seed. In the lower right, we're probing a location in the lower right region, a region known as parietal cortex, and we see functional connectivity with nearby regions and with regions that are long distance in the same and in the opposite hemisphere. In the lower left, you can see a different seed location reveals functional connectivity of a very different character for a different brain location. We can do that everywhere, and as slide 37 shows, one of the issues, though, that we have to face up to is that comparisons across individuals is extremely challenging owing to the individual variability that I showed in a preceding slide. So the upper left shows the reminder of the same variability you saw in four individuals. In the upper right, you see an example of the kind of alignment of cortical areas across many different subjects achieved by conventional methods. And in the lower text panels, I draw attention to an exciting new method known as multimodal surface matching, or MSM, developed by our colleagues at Harvard that essentially elevate our ability greatly to compare alignment across subjects. So in slide 39, you can see in the upper panels information from a single HCP participant for four different modalities. In the upper left is the folding map of the type you've seen before for that individual. The second panel shows a myelin map of the type I'd shown in a previous slide, but for that individual. In the third panel, you can see the functional connectivity for a particular seed location in the black spot is a seed location at the myelinated hotspot. And showing functional connectivity with nearby and long distance regions, including a region known as the frontal eye fields, or FEF. And in the upper right is the functional, the task activation for one particular task contrast in that individual. In the middle panel, you see the same kind of data, but now for a different individual subject. And in the lower panel, you can see the informative but somewhat blurry patterns that occur when one looks at this using conventional folding-based registration. In the next slide, number, if we go to slide 42, you can see that when we use this new method of multimodal surface matching, we achieve much crisper alignment, particularly obvious in the lower right panels where the sharpness of the group average is much improved, and that's a tremendous benefit that we're gaining from not only the higher quality of data, but the better methods of analysis. Slide number 43 moves our agenda on to some brief comments about data mining. And One manifestation of that is to illustrate the kinds of higher level data that we've analyzed in the HCP consortium and that we're making available to the community. So one way of probing resting state functional connectivity is to use a method called independent components analysis, and that is essentially a way of taking the resting state functional MRI data and looking for regions that have a common time course and therefore are parts of a common network or ICA node. On the upper right, you see an example group average ICA map or node that is informative about the functional organization of that region of the brain. But we can do this for many different nodes in a systematic analysis. And in the lower right, you can see a network matrix, or NetMat, as we affectionately call it. It shows the same kind of information that we saw in earlier anatomical connectivity maps, but now generated from functional MRI data and illustrating the kinds of information available for the group average and for individual subjects being freely shared with the community by virtue of data mining portals that are shown in slide 45. Basically, this shows a pointer to the Human Connectome Project's Connectome DB repository that thousands of people are accessing and using to drill down into this rich repository of information. So to bring us into the concluding few slides for this presentation, the slide 46 shows us that the we're in the advanced stages of exploring human brain circuitry, which is truly a grand challenge for this century. The Human Connectome Project is going to help elucidate brain connectivity and its variability in healthy adults. We're already seeing major discoveries and insights starting to emerge, a lot yet to come. But to control our aspirations, we have to realize that a complete full resolution connectome, that is micro and macro of the type that I've mentioned before, is really well outside our grasp by the methods we currently have or even can see on the horizon. So we have to manage our expectations and achieve a balance between optimism and excitement, but keeping a critical eye on the limitations of the current methods. We anticipate that future studies of diseases and development and aging will be become much more informative, and they'll aid in diagnosis and treatment of many brain disorders and diseases. And in that regard, we're very excited that to be in a transitional phase. We're now in the fifth and final year of our main HCP endeavor to study healthy adults, but already National Institutes of Health has indicated a major commitment to extend this approach in two sets of projects. One, to study brain connectivity and organization across the lifespan in two separate projects that are now being competitively open for proposals. And in the next bullet, there's a separate set of projects to be funded at different institutions using the HCP style methods, but focusing on connectomes of human diseases. So we hope that this will lead to deeper insights across a spectrum of the diseases that are the scourge of in terms of human suffering and human costs. The data that's acquired by both the lifespan and connectomes of human disease endeavors will be shared in a common portal centered at Washington University. It's essentially an extension and expansion of the ConnectomeDB I mentioned briefly a moment ago, but it's now will be entitled the Connectome Coordination Facility because it will draw in data from multiple projects, from multiple institutions and consortia. So we are excited that this type of coordinated effort will lead to better yield, richer, more informative data, and better use of the taxpayer dollar for the investments that are put into studying brain circuits in health and disease. So slide 48 brings us to a wrap-up analogy. In the upper left, we're reminded that classical maps of the Earth are quaint and now well outdated, but they had their charm for centuries. In the upper right, classical maps of the human brain have been around for a century. The next pair reminds us that book atlases were transformative for our understanding of the Earth's surface, as have been brain atlases in book form that served their purpose for a couple of decades. In the lower left, we're reminded that satellite imagery was incredibly important for giving us higher resolution maps of the Earth's surface. And in the lower right, functional MRI and surface-based analysis have greatly helped us in exploring the human brain. The last two panels remind us that Google Earth has been wildly transformative about the way we navigate the Earth's surface. And the final panel, we hope that the kinds of advances in human connectomics that I've been able to illustrate today take us forward in important and exciting ways in understanding human brain function. So in the penultimate slide, 49, I return to give my deep thanks to a group of investigators. I can't name them all, but as we walk through them, Deanna Bartsch, Camille Ugerville, Steve Smith, Dan Marcus, and Matt Glasser have all contributed in hugely important ways to the success of this endeavor. And lastly, I return to the slide I showed earlier to try to tease you into taking a serious look at spending a week in Hawaii, not a bad place to be in June. And if this is at all of interest to you, you can go to our website and learn more about this possibility. So that concludes my organized comments. Apologies again for the snafu with regard to seeing clearly what I was showing, but I see there are some additional questions. Should I go on to those then, I think? So Jenny Cruz asks, is there an equivalent connectivity pathway data set for the rodent brain? And the answer is absolutely yes. It's another one that's hot off the press. There are actually several advances, and one of them that is particularly exciting is from the Allen Brain Institute in Seattle. If you Google the Allen Institute, you'll find that they've released an enormous treasure trove of information about not only the human brain, but the mouse brain. And that includes a very rich information about mouse brain circuitry and connectivity, analogous to what I showed you for the human brain, but acquired using very sophisticated and powerful data acquisition techniques. Another question is it possible to study the connectivity of the diseased brains, such as Huntington's and Alzheimer's and other neurodegenerative diseases? Absolutely, yes. So there's actually a lot of that that's already been going on, particularly for Alzheimer's and other neurodegenerative diseases. There are a number of major projects that have been funded for some years that are giving us extremely important information about what's going wrong in neurodegeneration, and in particular in Alzheimer's. Some of these involve the same kinds of functional MRI and structural MRI modalities that I've been talking about today. Others involve really important complementary methods such as positron emission tomography that give us information about markers that give a signature of impending Alzheimer's, but years in advance of the onset of clinical symptoms. And this is really important for the prospects of developing treatments that can hopefully be able to take effect well before serious degeneration has occurred, and will hopefully have higher prospects of having a truly beneficial effect. So there's a lot of effort of this that are underway, particularly for Alzheimer's. Another question is, what type of analysis is being yielded in the HCP regarding brain effective connectivity? I think what this is pointing to is that there are a number of advanced types of analysis of brain imaging signals for both the functional MRI and the magnetoencephalography that I touched briefly upon. Included among these are measures known as effective connectivity that use advanced algorithms beyond the type that I illustrated today. I'm not an expert on them. I know that they are very interesting and intriguing, and that's one of the reasons we're extremely glad that the HCP data are being made publicly accessible, because investigators who know about additional methods that may be informative can take the current data sets and run with them and take them in directions that go well beyond what our consortium has had time to tap into. So, like I say, this is the tip of the iceberg in terms of the explorations, and we hope that new insights and discoveries will be made by the community at large using a wide variety of analysis and visualization methods. Okay, so that wraps up our time allocation pretty close, and the questions that were posted. So I think I'll turn it over to Brenda to wrap this up.
Thank you very much, Dr. Van Essen, for your interesting questions, participation, and slides for today. Today's webcast will be available for on-demand viewing for the next few months, and you'll receive an email from LabRoots alerting you when this webcast will be available for replay. We invite you to forward that announcement to your colleagues who may have missed today's live event. Thank you very much. See you next time. Goodbye.